morning. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let us all rejoice and be glad, because this is the day that the Lord has made. I want you to stand to your feet, give the Lord a hand clap of praise. It's been a long week, long week. We ought to be glad God brought us this far. Join in with the choirs, they lead us in praise and worship, followed by the invocation by the brother Michael Timms and the scripture by the brother Lee Andrews.
Lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me. Come on, sing it now. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me.
Let us pray. Eternal and most merciful Father, we just come to the throne of grace once again just to say thank you, God. Thank you for waking us up this morning and starting us on our way. Lord God, thank you for granting us a day we've never seen before. We just want to say thank you. Lord God, when we woke up and opened our eyes, we could look upon our loved ones and say good morning. Thank you. We had clothes on our back, Lord. You put food on our table this morning, Lord God. Shoes on our feet. Money in our pocket. And you allowed us to come to the house of praise once again. Thank you. Thank you. Father God, we just thank you for allowing us to assemble here. Assemble in a way that we never will again, Lord God. As we look to our left and look to our right, some of us didn't make it this morning. Some of us didn't wake up this morning. Lord God, some of us were too sick to make it to the house this morning. So we just say thank you. Thank you for life. Lord God, we just pray for those right now that are sick and shut in, Lord God, that could not raise up this morning. Grant them healing right now in the blessed name of Jesus. We pray for those behind prison walls, Lord God. We pray for our elderly, those in nursing homes, those that are homeless, Lord God, without shelter or food. Bless them today, Lord. We pray for every church this morning, Lord God, that's lifting up the name of Jesus. Thank you. Lord God, we pray for Pastor Crutcher and his family as they travel. Grant them peace on their journey and bring them back to us safely, Lord God, in the mighty name of Jesus. Now, Father God, we pray for those that need a healing this morning. Lord God, you know who we are. You know what we're in need of. So we just claim it right now in the mighty name of Jesus. We claim our healing. We claim our victory. Lord God, we pray that you would just bless these men this morning that are singing your praises, that have come together to bless your holy name, Lord God. We pray for our young people, Lord God. Watch over them now that school is out, Lord God. Occupy their minds. Bless them. Keep them out of trouble, Lord God. Inspire them, Lord God, that they may read your word and study this summer, Lord God, and help one another. Lord God, we pray for this wicked, wicked world that we live in. Lord God, we've made a mess of things, Lord God, and we need you to fix it. Fix it, Lord. Lord God, we know that only you have the ability to fix it. So we're claiming right now that it is healed. Our world is healed and our nation is healed because you said so in your word, Lord God. You would never leave us or forsake us. And we just claim that right now in the matchless name of Jesus. Now, Father God, be on every pew. Be within every heart right now, Lord God. We move everything out of the way so that we may worship you. Bless the pastor that's bringing forth the word, Reverend Counsel, this morning, Lord God. Bless him from the crown of his head to the tip of his toes, Lord God, that he may bring forth your word so that someone may come forth and ask, what must I do to be saved? Lord God, all these and many, many other blessings we ask in your son Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, Madam. I shall be reading for you this morning the epistle from the book of Ephesians, the 6th chapter, verses 10 through 20, and from the New International Version. Let those come in who need to come in. Let those come in. And the scripture reads this morning, finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the enemy's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything to stand, stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints. Pray also for me, that whenever I open my mouth, words may be given me so that I will fearlessly make known the mysteries of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
It's a beautiful morning. You woke up this morning and started on your way. You find yourself sitting in a place where people come with high expectation, seeking a word from on high. And then you come to say thank you to an almighty God. Then you come to say thank you. See, because you could have been on the other side this morning. You could have been in so much pain you couldn't have moved. You could have got in that car and never got out the driveway. That's why we come to say thank you. We have an almighty God. That's worth praising for. That's worth shouting about. That's why we come. We're expecting something. We want to be different. We don't want to be the same. We owe it to ourselves. And we owe it to everybody whose life we come in contact with, because we represent God. It's a beautiful day. Beautiful day. We will now have a member of the Courtesy Guild to come, and followed by the steward board, who will bring forth our announcement.
Good morning, Mount Olive. Do we have any visitors with us this morning? If so, would you please stand at this time? I see none, but I just want to greet you in the name of Jesus. And that scripture, put on the full armor of God, and it instructs us to stand. And I said in my mind, stand, God, you'll give me a word for each one of those letters. And he just started to pour them into my spirit this morning. S is secure. Ah, God, we come in this place to get equipped. So whatever struggles that we go through, that we can be secure and trusting God. That's the T. And that we can be alert for the schemes, for the enemy, for the things that come in our pathway. And we can remember that we are never, never alone. That he is always with us. And therefore, we can dare to stand. Thank you this morning, Mount Olive.
Good morning. I have just a few announcements for you. If you'll look on the back of your bulletin, you'll see everything that's going on this week. I do want to call your attention to Saturday, June 16th, where you see pink tea at 4 p.m. That is an incorrect date and time. That will not happen in June. That's going to happen sometime later on in the year. So take that off your calendar for this week. I want also to note a couple of things and bring them to your attention as well. This afternoon at 4 p.m. we'll be having an afternoon in black and white. That is our Hymns of the Church program that we have scheduled to help us celebrate our 137th anniversary, church anniversary. So please come back this afternoon at 4 p.m. There are a lot of different things going on with the hymns that you'll enjoy, I'm sure. One thing in particular, the Weaver sisters are going to be here. So you know how wonderful they are and how much we like to hear them sing. So come back this afternoon at 4 o'clock. And from 4 to 6 is the time frame. So come back this afternoon at 4 o'clock for the hymn sing. The other announcement I want to bring to your attention, it's the third one on the list, ministers, stewards, musicians, and all choir members, Mass Praise Team, Mass Choir Praise Team, Youth Choir, and the Posse. Pastor Crutcher wants to meet with all of us on June 24th, right after the 10 o'clock service in the Fellowship Hall. So put that on your calendar. You can see who all is invited, and we look forward to seeing all of you there. Let's see, there is one other announcement. Yes, the lay organization will be selling jackets to raise some funds. If you need any details, see Minerva Peterson. I know she's here. I saw her earlier this morning. But see Minerva if you want to get some information about the jackets that they will be selling. She can tell you everything you need to know about that. So Minerva, be ready. Everybody's going to come see you in just a few minutes. So those are all of the announcements that I want to bring to your attention today. So mark your calendars and put the dates in your phones and save the dates and all those different kinds of things. And we'll be looking forward to seeing you later on today and further on in the week. Thank you.
Traditional way. Please hold up your gifts. High to God. God, this is my gift. It is a seed I planted in this ministry. I'm expecting a harvest in this ministry and in my life. I'm expecting it to be exceedingly, abundantly, above all I expect, all that I can think, and all that I can imagine. Lord, I most humbly thank you. I'm able to give. In Jesus' name, amen. things.
All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given.
Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen again. It's preaching time. Oh, y'all ain't even sound like y'all enthusiastic. It's preaching time. Maybe it's me. It's preaching time. Oh, yeah. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. It's preaching time. It's time for a word. It's time for some inspiration. Yeah, it is. I don't have to introduce you to our speaker of the hour. I just need you to know he's come to preach. He has a word sent from on high that he's coming to share with us. And I hope all of you all are ready to receive the word. Say amen again. Say, I'm ready. I'm ready. Okay, well then I'd like for you to stretch out your hand, the right hand toward the pulpit, and just say, preach. Preach the word that God gave you to give to me. Thank you. Thank you. After the singing by the posse, I present to you none other than our own Reverend James Counsel. Hear ye him.
Going nowhere till you bless me. Without your blessing, Lord, I can't make it at all. I'm not going to let you go till you bless me. I'm not gonna let you go till you bless me. Without your blessing, Lord, I can't make it at all. Please, please, Lord, help me. I got faith in you, and I bless you too. I'm gonna stay right here till you bless me. I'm gonna stay right here till you bless me. Without your blessing, Lord, I can't make it at all. Please, Lord, I have faith in you and I trust you too. I'm gonna sit and wait because you're never too late. Please, Lord, I got faith in you, and I trust you too. I'm gonna sit and wait because you're never too late. Please, Lord. Oh. Come on, Jesus. I need you. I need you. I need you right now. I need you to bless my home. I need you to bless my children. I need you to bless my heart. I need you to bless my mind. I ain't going nowhere. I ain't going nowhere. I ain't going nowhere until you bless my soul. I need you to bless my mind. I need you to bless my heart. I need you to bless my walk. I need you to bless my living. Hey, hey, or would you bless my mind? Or would you bless my feet? Or would you bless my hands? Or would you bless my tongue? Come on, Jesus. Come on, Jesus. Come on, Jesus. I need you. I need you right now. I need you to bless my soul. I need your power. Your holy power. Come on, Jesus. Come on, Jesus. I'm gonna sit and wait. I'm gonna sit and wait. Cause you're never too late.
Never too late.
Please,
please,
please, Lord.
Check, check.
Say amen. We truly want God to bless us. Bless us in our going out and our coming in. Dear Father, we ask that you bless us. Good morning, Mount Olive. It is a pleasure to be standing here this morning, and truly a blessing to be standing here this morning. Give it honor to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He is my one and only Father and my Redeemer. Giving thanks to those earthly beings, the Bishop Richardson, by Mrs. Richardson, our elder, Mrs. Walker, and truly the pastor of this magnificent church, my pastor, my father, the Reverend Dr. Mark A. Crutcher. Thank them for allowing me to not only be a part of this ministry of the church, but to stand here this morning before you, delivering the word. To the officers and the choir, and my brothers and sisters, my beautiful wife, Deborah. You notice I kept it short. She told me not to say too much about her this morning. May we go on to our service with a prayer. Gracious God, we offer to you our praise. We thank you for the great measure of your love and the redemptive power of your grace. Be pleased in your mercy to come to every one of us just now as we come before you and finding you what nothing in this world can give. redemption from our sin, and peace that cannot be taken away, and hope that is unashamed, unafraid. For your mercy's sake, O God, deal with us in all this hour. Remind us that we have to go out of this place as weak as we were when we came in. We bring before you the needs of this world, the needs of our neighbors and our personal needs. Let the miracle of your grace happen here and now with each of us as we come before you humbly in silent prayer. So, dear Father, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Lord, bless now the words of the preacher. Allow him to forget himself, his mediocrity, and the effect that he would like to produce, so that he can speak solely and in all truth of you and your doctrine, so that he can say the things that all his listeners have been waiting for. Something that truly comes from you and filled with your love, filled with your wisdom, the wisdom which is not in this world. Amen. We want to bring your attention this morning to a scripture that we read quite often. It comes from the Gospel of John 14, starting with verse 1. It said, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself. That where I am, there you may be also. And whither I go, or where I go, ye know. And the way, ye know." Use the subject this morning of preparation at hand. Preparation is at hand. Jesus' words show that the way to eternal life, though unseen, is secure. It's secure for us because he said, "I go to prepare a place for you." So that is as secure as our trust is in Jesus. He has already prepared the way for eternal life. The only issue is, that may still be unseen, is what is our willingness to believe? We say that we don't know the way. Jesus said that we do know the way. He has gone to prepare a place for us. It is our bounden duty to prepare ourselves to get to the place. It may be a house. It may be some rooms, as it says in some scriptures. However, in this scripture, it said it had many mansions. So we must come to him if we want to be saved. There's a song that says, "Come to Jesus, just now. Not later, but just now." We must do it. Believe it, do it, stand for it, and spread it. So not only does Jesus want us to come to him, but he wants us to go out for him. So let's set up a plan. An outline, so to speak, for preparation. We always have to prepare for whatever we are going to do in life. Sometimes it doesn't come to us in the form of an outline or in writing, so to speak. But all through life, there are preparations. We start out as young kids, and our parents take us to kindergarten. Although we don't know it or not, at that age, we're being prepared for grade school. You go to grade school, you're being prepared for higher education. In higher education, you're being prepared for college. All during that time, the preparation is going on. The process is going on. First thing that you're told is, what are you going to be? Or ask, rather, what are you going to be in life? And you pick some occupation or whatever. So if you're going into, say, we're going to pick out, you're going into medicine, you don't take a whole lot of English subjects. You want to take what? Biology, chemistry. So here we are preparing to go to be with Jesus. So I picked out three elements that we need in order to do that. Number one is patience. Number two is posture. And number three is purpose. And in Proverbs 16:1-2, it says the preparation of the heart in man and the answer of the tongue is always from the Lord. All the ways of a man is clean in his own eyes, but the Lord weigheth the spirit. So we must have spirit. The Christian is exhorted to lead a life worthy of the calling. With all lowliness, meekness, and patience, forbearing one another in love. That's Ephesians 4. So we must get right with the Lord. The only way to become right with God is to believe in Him. And believing in Him is to have faith. And faith requires patience. It was faith that made Abraham righteous in God's sight. It was his faith that made him do what God told him to do. And it's faith that will give you and me the power of God on our side. The way is not easy. And we will be confronted with many stumbling blocks and run upon many mountains. But if you believe in God, then these mountains and stumbling blocks will be just like pebbles in the sand. Faith and patience can and will move mountains. Let's have patience and come to the Lord. Second is posture. Correct posture in our lives, and when I say posture, I'm not speaking of the way that I stand with my feet anchored upon this floor. I'm speaking of posture in a Christian way. Correct posture in a Christian way is praise. Praise to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Praise and prayer. Prayer is in direct contact with God. It isn't meditation. It's not contemplation, but it's a true conversation, a back and forth with God, who has the power to do all that you ask. Prayer is where you plead with the one who can do anything. Prayer is free access to the Creator of the universe, available to all who make Jesus the Lord of their lives. Make everything that you do through Christ Jesus. And the Word of God says you can be sure that He hears your prayers, and He will answer according to His will. He listens to your pleadings. When Jesus told the parable of the widow and the judge in Luke 18:2-8, He said, "We should cry to Him for help day and night." You have to pray in the morning, in the noonday, at supper time, in the midnight hour. We all know about that midnight hour. That midnight hour does not have to be 12 o'clock at night. That midnight hour could be when you get a message from your doctor that you have an ailment, or you get a message that your child is in trouble. That's the midnight hour. That midnight hour is when tears start to fall because of something that's going on in your life. But as the saying goes, weeping may endure for a night, but truly, 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 joy comes in the morning. And I've heard it said, don't be too proud to be. Don't be too proud to be. Get on your knees. I don't know if you heard of Hannah in the Bible. In Samuel 1 through 15, it said, Hannah poured out her heart to the Lord so much thought that she was drunk. Don't be too proud today. That's the posture that we should have if we want to prepare to go to the place that Jesus is preparing for us. And the last point is the purpose. Some of you possibly have read the book, Purpose for Your Life. It's all about destiny and how you're going to get there. The Bible tells us in Romans 12:2, let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will know what God wants you to do. I'll read that again. Let God transform you, in other words, change you into a new person by changing the way you think. The Bible says what? As a man thinketh, so is he. Then you will know what God wants you to do. When God gives you a vision for your future, or your purpose, you don't have to share it with everyone in order to make it real. Because sometimes God gives you a vision of things that you need to do and the way that you need to go. And you're going to take that and you're going to run with it, but you may be running the wrong way. So don't make yourself look, so to speak, stupid. So sometimes your service to God will go unannounced and your devotion won't be seen, or your devotion won't be understood. by anyone but you. As you spend more time in the presence of God, you will find yourself with all the encouragement you need to do what you have been asked. His approval is the only approval you need. You don't need my approval. You don't need your neighbor's approval. Your son, your daughter, your husband, your wife, all the approval you need is from my Lord and Savior. Fulfill your purpose through your obedience to Almighty God. And the Apostle Paul challenged believers of this day to learn what every believer would do well to know and remember. The key to making progress in the realm of Christian freedom and destiny is to keep walking in the Spirit, found in Galatians 5:22-26. Walking in obedience of God with the gift of the Spirit that you alone possess. But to exercise your gift always with love. Because regardless of whatever your gift is, if you are without love in your heart, you are nothing. As the scripture says, it's like a sounding cymbal. We live in times where we get brainwashed. And we end up worshiping other gods and not following Jesus as we should. We end up looking at things not out of love, but out of hate. And we know that if God is love, then we should be also love. John puts together a confessional test for the true believer. He does this to give a general criteria for distinguishing or recognizing what's true and what's false. This is in 1 John, by the way. He says, we are from God, and whoever knows God listens to us. And whoever is not from God does not listen to us. And this is how we recognize the spirit of truth and the spirit of falsehood. This, John adds, the test of love by saying, whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. In summary, God's love is our love. Love is not just a passing gesture or collection of thoughtful words, but a pure expression of true, unconditional love. And it's void of hatred, malice, jealousy, hurtfulness, gossip, made of forgiveness and compassion. It is a put on the whole armor of God type of love. Armor in the way of not war, but for loving one another in spirit and in truth. Our church theme for this period is transforming under the anointing, which is any action or attitude that expresses praise, faith, and appreciation for God. Part 2 of our Decalogue says, love thy neighbor as thyself. Romans 5:8. God demonstrates his love for us, and that when we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. The least we can do is show love to one another. get an amen on that. Amen. In John 1, in 1 John 3 and 1, the apostle reminds the love of God in making believers, you and me, his children. Verse 1, as believers, our self-worth is based on the fact that God loves us and calls us his children. We are his children now. It says just now, not just sometime in the distant future. Knowing that we are his children should encourage us to live as Jesus did, honoring and praising his Father at all times. Verses 1 and 2 tells us who we are. We are members of God's family, children of God. Then tells us that we are becoming reflections or likeness of God. The Christian life is a process of becoming more and more like Christ. This process will not only end until we are Christ, until we see Christ face to face. Knowing this should motivate us to fulfill this destiny by purifying ourselves. This part of the process means to keep morally straight, free from corruption and sin. Jesus in his teaching and practice emphasized the need for purity of heart as a basic requirement for eternal life. In Jesus' last day with his disciples, we read in John 14, 1 through 4, he states that he is going to prepare a place for us. He said that he is coming back for us. He said that we knew the way. John has told us that one of the most important ways is to love one another. We are all in the preparation period together. With patience, posture, and purpose. We have a shared mission to get to the place that Jesus has prepared for us. So we're going to keep on walking, keep on talking, walking up King's Highway, you see. Let's fill the place. Doing my research, I ran upon something that I had in my file. I don't know where it came from, but I thought it would be appropriate to read it this morning. It says, some of you may have heard it already, that the directions to heaven. First of all, and this is not MapQuest. It's just direction to heaven. First of all, whosoever will must make a U-turn on the road to repentance. Then make a right onto Believeth Boulevard. Keep straight and go through the green light, which is Jesus Christ. From there, you must turn onto the bridge of faith, which is over troubled water. When you get off the bridge, make a right turn and keep straight. You're on the King's Highway, heaven bound. Keep going for 3 miles, one for the Father, one for the Son, and one for the Holy Ghost. Then exit off on the Grace Boulevard. From there, make a right turn on Gospel Lane. Keep straight and then make another right on Prayer Boulevard. As you go on your way, yield not to the traffic on Temptation Avenue. Also avoid Sin Street because it is a dead end. Pass up Envy Drive and Hate Avenue. Also pass up Hypocrisy Street, Gossiping Lane, and Backbiting Boulevard. But you have to go down Long Suffering Road, Persecution Boulevard, and Trials and Tribulation Avenue. From there, make another right onto Peace Street. Keep straight and you will come to the parking lot of Immortality. It's all right to park there, free of charge. Get out of the body and junk it. Go into the building not made by hands. Sit down and talk to King Jesus. Tell him all about your troubles and dwell in his house forever. Amen.
Are you prepared? How is your patience level? What's your posture? Are you fulfilling your purpose? Can people see the love in you wherever you go? The doors of the church were open some 2,000 years ago. We now open the doors of the church, asking you to come, beseeching you, offering you an opportunity to increase your posture, help you find your purpose, and to build up your patience level. The doors of the church are open. That's why we're here. We're going to show you the best love we can. Please come. As the choir sings, the doors of the church are open. The opportunity is upon us. The time is now. Come on, fall in love with Jesus. Get your praise on. Increase your prayers.
Falling in love with Jesus.
Come on and fall in love again. Wonderful word. I love that word. Kind of wish we could make a little poster of that, the poem at the end, and hang it up somewhere. That's a nice little poem you said there, whatever that was. That was very well spoken. We run across all those roads as we travel this Christian highway. Sorry, y'all. I'm getting caught up in the words of that song. They keep echoing in my mind. I do have an additional announcement. It says we will be celebrating the birthday of the Reverend Juanita Crutcher Wednesday night before Bible study. They're asking that you please bring your gifts, cards, monetary donations. They will be having this celebration between 5:45 and 6:45 p.m. Please see Sister Deborah Harvard or leave any donations or gifts you have in the church office. Thank you. Have a blessed day, the birthday committee. Amen. Our heart satisfied. Let us all stand and praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge of love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And may the blessings of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst us today, henceforth, and evermore. May we say,
Yeah, I'm gonna go check it out. Good morning, church school. Brother Fuller, come to close those doors for me, please. Thank you. And those who are not going to participate in church school, would you please exit the sanctuary at this time? Our hymn of praise is going to be hymn number 5. This is a good opportunity for us to go through all of the procedures that we would normally go through in Sunday school because we have the time to do it. Now, I'm not going to try to out-talk the fellowship hall this morning, so let's just put a boundary on where we are and come as close as we can, and we'll do the best that we can. Let us stand. Hymn number 5. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prosper before. Let angels prosper before. Bring forth a royal diadem and crown him, crown him, crown him, crown him, crown him, Lord of all. Verse 5. Oh, that ye on the sacred throne we at his feet may fall, we at his feet may fall. We'll join the everlasting song and crown him, crown him, crown him, crown him, and crown him, Lord of all. Most gracious Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before your presence this morning, Almighty God, to crown him Lord of all, King of all kings, the creator, sustainer. I was glad when they said, let us come into the house of the Lord, that our feet may stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem. So God, we're grateful this morning. Some of us come with baggage. Some of us come with illnesses. Some of us come because we're in need of prayer. Some of us come because we're in need of hearing the word. But God, whatever our situation is, we've come to unite and just to lift you up this morning. Because we know that you're able to do all things through you, oh God. So we're just so grateful this morning. Now bless us, Lord. Help us to be obedient to your word. Oh God, help us to plant good seeds, oh God. Realizing that when we all must bow down and answer to you, that you would do the separation. Oh God, so we're so grateful this morning. Oh God, that you spare our lives to be here and to worship you this morning. Now, Lord, teach us to pray as you taught your disciples by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Turn in front of your book for the Apostle Creed. it says that I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, Church Universal, the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, life everlasting. Amen. Decalogue, and God spoke all these words, and I am the Lord thy God who brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. I shall have no other gods before me. Lord, have mercy upon us and incline our hearts to keep this law. Thou shalt not make unto thyself any graven image, nor the likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or in the earth beneath, or in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers unto the children, unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and show mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. Lord, have mercy upon us and incline our hearts to keep this law. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain. Lord, have mercy upon us and incline our hearts to keep this law. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shall thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. And if thou shalt not do any work, thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord hath made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them is, and rested on the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the seventh day and hallowed it. Lord, have mercy upon us and incline my hearts to keep my soul be owned by God. 10,000 poor shall rise, and host of sin oppressing heart, to draw thee from the sky. Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear forth witness against thy neighbor. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, nor his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, nor his ass, nor anything that is thy neighbor's. Lord, have mercy upon us and write these laws upon our hearts. Nearer, my God, to thee, nearer to thee. Evil it be a cause that raises me. Still, oh, my soul shall be nearer, my God, to thee, nearer, my God, to thee, nearer to thee. Hear what Christ our Savior says. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments, and all the law and the prophets. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen. May be seated. So, Sister, I want you to take account of everybody in here. That's our total. We have got to learn that the total does not count when people scribe it in. The total counts when the superintendent rang that bell and we start going through the process. Okay? This morning, I'm just blessed to be here. I wasn't scheduled to be here. I had made preparation and share with others that I would be out of town. but God always has a way of working things out. And to be honest with you, I'm not feeling well at all. I was thinking about it this morning. I said, you know, I thought about Ella Jenkins and the respiratory problems that she had, the stroke. And I said, if it was anything like I'm going through this morning, man, that's a struggle she went through. So we have to take an opportunity and give God praises and be glad. Like I said this morning, I was glad when they said unto us, let us go into the house of the Lord, and our peace will stand within thy gates. So I'm grateful to be here this morning. Let me get one other thing clear. I'll mention also while I was up here before I let Reverend Gaston come forward. I want you all to start thinking about some replacements. And there's a lot of openness that's going to be available on the next conference year. So, and superintendent is one of them. And so I want you to think about that. And there are some teachers slots that we're going to need to fill. So we need your support, and we need those of you all who may know folks who would like to step up and take charge in terms of teaching. Please do it now. You got 2 months to get the experience and training behind you. We'll be here for you. We're going to support you. But we need you to come forth and do so. Okay? I'll let Reverend Gaston make her announcement. But at this time, let's welcome Reverend Gaston. Let's give a hand clap, please, as she comes forth to share with us today's lesson. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. This was a last-minute thing in talking with Reverend Cotton last night. Usually when I'm out of place or she may be out of place, we will switch our time because we go the second Sunday. So I will be out of place next month. So therefore, I'm standing before you this morning in her stead. And the lesson this morning is about God, parables of God's just kingdom. This quarter, we are talking about justice. And as we listen, as we see, as we read, we know that justice may be something far removed right now, so it seems, because of all the things that are taking place in our society today, because of all the, I want to say, disbeliefs, because of all the violence, and I'm even going to go back, because of the lack of home training, we're running rapidly, because of the beliefs of those who are in political offices. It seems to be that everything goes but the Word of God. And it's like, do what you want to do, when you want to do it. And that's not how God told us. That's not what His Word tells us. God is a God who does things decent and in order. And our motto states that in God we trust. So if we are trusting in God, then surely we are believing in His Word, and we're going to make every attempt that we can to live according to His Word. But it seems to be the chosen few. So we go to our lesson where it talks about parables of God. Jesus taught things in parables. Why did he teach in parables? Why did he do that? Yeah, I want to answer.
The parables were simple stories. They were a visual picture of the atmosphere of things that were happening currently at the time. And it was agriculture. And that's why you always saw those kinds of things that were around. And I grew up in a farming area. So immediately I know about seeds and harvesting and all of those kinds of things. So that's how they came to, the vision would come to you and make sense to you.
Just going to say each parable provided an interpretation of what is coming of the kingdom of God.
It's telling what's coming.
The lesson's definition for parable says that it's a simple story, as Sister Smith said, used to illustrate a moral or spiritual lesson as told by Jesus in the Gospels. Allegory. And when you think about that, a simple story is illustrate what moral or spiritual kind of situations. So right away I thought about the parable of this lesson in terms of separation. And you see what's going on into the world today. You know, we can't get caught up in you know who. Because God is going to do what? He's going to do the separation.
I will do the separation. He is the one who will judge all. In light of increasing opposition, Jesus spends time teaching those who are interested in following him. Matthew 13 gives us the third major discourse in the gospel. In that chapter alone, we have eight parables that explain more about Jesus and his kingdom. All right, our scripture text this morning is Matthew 13, chapter 13, verses 24 through 30. Our key verse says, "Let both of them grow together until the harvest, and at harvest time I will tell the reapers, collect the wheat first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn." Amen. Ah, okay, when we think about the weeds and we think about the seeds. All right, we can distinguish the difference, can we not? We know what the difference is. The first parable is the parable of the sower. It illustrates how seeds are sown and cultivated in different environments. We know that you can't plant the same seed in fertile soil as you do in rocky sand. You can't plant the same seeds in clay as you do in the fertile soil. Things grow differently, things will die. So we have to be careful as to where we plant and expect things to grow. Some things just won't take root. I don't care how we try. We want it to, we pray, we ask, but when that opposition is so strong against it, it's not, we may want it for somebody, but they've got to want it too. And when they keep fighting and fighting, and their time is up, and they haven't given in, Well, God knew this would happen, but he had us hang in there. And we know he has a purpose behind everything. So we keep praying. We keep fasting. We keep asking. We don't give up. We keep putting out a word. With my grandsons, I have to send them a text. They may respond back, they may not. But my goal is to plant the seed. And eventually, even with Jeremiah, and he doesn't respond. But I asked him, did you get your text? Yes. All right. Did you read it? Yes. All right. But I just keep giving it. I keep giving it. And I just believe that's what I have to do, what I need to do. Sure, my boys were trained. I keep saying my boys, they are. They were trained in the church, grew up in the church. But when they got older, with Yuquan, work became more excessive to them. With Isaiah, I always tell him, I say, you want to be a street thug and don't even know how. He doesn't have that mentality. And he doesn't understand that. So he's going to try to fit into the world's system. And I told him at a young age, I said, son, you were not meant to fit into the world. I said, and I know that it's hard for you to understand. But God set you aside, and you're not meant to fit in. And as hard as he tries, he can't fit in. Regardless of what he might do, he still can't fit in. So one day, my prayer is that he will open his eyes, because he has blinded eyes. But he will one day open his eyes, and he will see what God has set him aside for. Jeremiah the prophet will be Jeremiah the prophet. That's just in him. And he can't get away from it. But I could call him Peter, because he does at that temple. But he already knows that he belongs to an almighty God. And he's the one who will sit down and will talk with you. So the weed, I said the weeds and the seed. Planting the seed into the seed. Because we do have to plant. We do have to. God has put us here to do that. When we go out amongst the people, what do we have to do? We have to talk about the Lord. I experienced something in all these years that I've been going to Paramore. I experienced something the other week when we went down. And I call them my people, because they are my people. I feel that connection with them. And it was one who came there who had not been there before, never been there before. And he immediately walked up to the car, reached in and got him a bag. And I said, no. We don't do it like that. I said, pass it back to me and just wait. And that's all I could say, because at that point, the other guys just took over. And I had to just bring them down. Because they were saying, man, we don't do anything like that. We have respect. Now, if you can't wait to get your bag, then you need to go on. I mean, they lit into me. And I said, Lord, look at how your people are. Look at how they are. They know and they understand that first we pray. We pray. We go before God. They release the hats. They release the cigarettes. And we pray. And they don't let anybody come and disrupt their order, because they know how to do things. And that's God moving in them. Did they come to church? No. If we talk about, do you know Jesus? Are you saved? Have you been baptized? Everybody's going to say yeah. And I understand why they say yes. So you can't carry your conversation but just so far. Then you've got those who will stand there and talk to you about the Lord day in and day out. I know I'm not doing the right thing in my life. I know I need to put down this alcohol. But I also know that God is real. And God has been taking care of me and keeping me every day. So at first I thought, well, Lord, nobody's trying. I'm not getting anybody to go to church. And God said, I didn't send you here for that. That's not your mission. But your mission is to go forth and be amongst my people and let them know that, yes, I am real. That's all you need to let them know. I am real. And what I do for one, I do for them. And I believe I've done much of what he's asked. Because I do have repeat people. I've been down there, what, 4 or 5 years now. And I've got repeaters who come and they know. They know what to expect. So I believe that I've done what he's asked me to do. And I know that I'm at the close of that season. But the seed and the weeds. Does God want all to be saved? He does. But we'll all be saved. It won't work that way. Because we've got some stout-hearted people who turn a deaf ear to God's word. So when he gives in the parable, he's making it plain so that we can understand. And then we have to decide on which side we're going to be. We have to make the decision. Am I for God or am I for the world? Because when we're in the world, we think we got it made. Because we're having fun, having a good time, not putting all that money in church, but doing what we want to do. Just like when the folk get there, the monies every month. They take care of their own personal needs. They forget about children and everybody else. Their personal needs come first. Where it should be, God coming first. And we give God thanks for all things. Now I know I've talked a lot, so I want you to express to me your understanding of the parables today. All right, and before we do that, let me, I want to go to verses 24 through 30. This parable indicates that wheat, which is the righteous, and the weeds, which is the wicked, grow together for the time being. We're all in this world, all here. We're growing together. Then we start branching off, start separating. We have some who will go on the right, some who will go on the left. Some are going to be right there in the middle. They're going to straddle a fence because they want both worlds. But does God want us to be that way? Can we have both worlds? Yeah, you got to make a decision. Either one or the other. You can't serve Satan and serve God. It just won't work that way. So you got to make that decision. So are you of the wicked or are you of the righteous? And I know and understand we, as with that human frailty, sometimes we gonna falter along the way. I tell you, I was at a point last night and I had to catch myself. My nephew and I were talking, and what he was telling me just burned my inner core. And I almost said it. And I had to stop right there, catch myself. And all I've been doing since then is just praying, talking to God, because I know God can do anything but fail. If God can't do it, it can't be done. So I know God will make the way out of no way. And that which seems to be something that can't be done, he's already done it. Already done it. Again, the enemy mixes bad seed with good seed during this age in an attempt to corrupt the entire crop. He doesn't want us to succeed. He doesn't want us to live and have life abundantly. He wants us to be a failure. He doesn't want us to be able to see the hope and the future that God has given us. He tries to put those blinders on. And with some, especially when things seem to be going bad, they fall into it. Especially when they have first accepted Christ and joined the church. And you know Satan will raise his head high and swing low. That's a testing time. That's a testing time. Do you really mean what you say when you say, I died for you, I gave my life for you, so that you may be able to live? Do you really mean what you say when you accept me as your Lord and Savior? Do you really mean it? Because it comes to a time we're going to have to take that stand, Lord, for you I live and for you I die. What it says, and nothing can separate us from the love of God. So it's a testing time. But a lot of times, we see them come. That first time, giving their hand to the pastor. But then they step back, and we don't see them anymore. And they haven't been here long enough to decide or to say to themselves, well, I'm in the right place. Or I'm in the wrong place. Because you haven't been here to even see what we're all about, other than that one service when God just captured your heart. So you have to believe that, yeah, Satan is on his road of trying to recover. But will he make it? Will he take this one? Will he pluck this one away? Or will this one stand? Understanding the role of the wicked and the role of the righteous. Because we as the righteous have to cover those who are on that road of the wicked. So when we cover them, we are pleading the blood of Jesus over their lives. And we are letting them know that we are standing in the gap for them. And we need you to keep praying. Come pray with us. Come trust. Come and believe. And God will make the difference. God will put in our hearts to just go ahead and say, Lord, I love you. I accept you. And I got to do what you say do. Regardless. Everything is not always gloom and doom. But what the song say, try Jesus. He's all right. Try Jesus, because I done tried it, and I know he's all right. Amen? So only at the final judgment or harvest will God, not us, because we good at judging. We got a hand on that thing. We good at judging. We good at looking at others. And we good at pointing out what others do and what others don't do. But what about ourselves? Lord God, am I standing in good standing with you? And you know, I have to say sometimes when I'm praying, I say, Lord, I pray that on this day, you found some kind of pleasure in me. Lord, I don't know if I made it, but I just pray you found some kind of pleasure in me, that I did something that brought pleasure to you. And I believe that when I'm willing to give of myself, step out of myself, I'm willing to serve, I'm willing to speak kindly, I'm willing to show love, I'm willing to share, I'm doing something. May not be all I can do, but I'm doing something along that way. Amen. All right, now would you talk to me, please?
Come. join the church and you won't see them again. Sometimes the reason why you won't see them again is because people plant negative seeds. When they walk in that door there, a negative seed may be planted. When they sit on that pew there, a negative seed may have been planted. So in times that we're living in now, people are hurting. People come here for a purpose, to hear the word, to be healed. And when they're approached with negative stuff that the world, that they're familiar with because of worldly stuff, they'll say, well, why am I here? Why should I even come back? So we have to be careful in terms of what types of seeds we plant, especially in the household of faith, but we should also do it in our daily lives. And that's not easy because the type of world that we're living in now is crazy. I thought about the G7 meeting that just occurred a couple of days ago, and I thought about the negative seed that was planted amongst those who were a part of the G7. And there was only one negative seed that was planted who went against everything else that the other six folks went with. Y'all guess who it was? Y'all know who it was? So what does that tell you? And it says to me that we are a nation who was built on the word of God. Our Constitution mentions the word of God. Our money has the word of God written on it. And yet, the people who supported this individual are folks who say that they are evangelicals. They are folks who are Christian folks. And I'm saying, how can you be live that type of lifestyle and believe in God and allow this type of stuff to go on? Negative seeds. Negative seeds. But you see, the world is what? It's continuously moved forward, right? Why? Because God said what? In his word. He's going to do what? In due season, he's going to separate. He's going to separate. And I thought about parables. Who can think of a parable that we often say on a regular basis in today's world? I can think of one. Remember where I said it takes what? It takes an entire village to raise a child. Is that true? It's true. That's a good parable, isn't it? It takes an entire village to raise a child. You ever heard of this before? You can't change spots on a leopard. Huh? In other words, you can talk until you turn blue. But if that person doesn't want to change, you're wasting your time. You lead the horse to the water, to the well, but you can't make him drink the water. That's another one. This one it says, what? You ever heard what it says? You elevate it up, don't go all the way up to the top. That means something missing upstairs. Something is missing upstairs there. So these parables, you know, it's sometimes you have to apply them to our daily lives and what it really, really means.
Going back to that original parable that you was talking about, the weed. Now, in my front yard, 3 times I put St. Augustine up there. But because across the street, they cut it, and those weeds just blow. And now we take I plant the same St. Augustine in my backyard, and it's thick. Now, that's telling me, because you do have to, like you say, observe, look for the good in all things. Now, I know there's no point in me going back out there worrying about that problem because it's not good soil. But in the back there, it maintains itself. And I use that parable to say, God will bring his in. And then on the outside out there, you have to separate yourself. God said, come and separate yourself from amongst them. So I have to realize that that's just a given. So that's bad soil. But on the back, and it's amazing because that's why I like to sit, because it's so serene back there, more so than on my front porch. So, you know, and I say that all the time, look for good in everything. And another Son of Man, that you care so much for him that you make him a little lower than the angels. And here God has put everything that I've put, and look what we do different. He determines whether or not we are of the seed or the wheat. When we love God enough to take care of what he's given unto us, that means we're putting him first. We're not putting things first, but we're putting God first, because we're thanking him for what he's done.
But you know they ain't nothing but weed, don't you? So you know God rain on the just and the unjust.
Yes, he does. And I thank him for raining on it. It'd be so pretty and green. And when you get up on it, then you see what it is. Yes, yes.
Dollar weeds, and if you don't pull them up from the root, they're going to come back. So I'm wasting my time. I said, I refuse to let these dollar weeds take over my yard. So I'm up there pulling them, and you know, pull them up, you know, but every time it rains, it seems as if everything's for naught. They pop right back up. So we have to, we just have to do what we can.
I don't know if God trying to tell me something, but we use a fertilizer, and the fertilizer was supposed to take care of all the weeds. This one particular we did, we got a brand new weed we had never seen before. Had never seen it. Did not find out what it was. We didn't know. So we had to do something else there. It looked like they're dying out. Now, I mean, the whole area, it grew evenly, nice and green. But I said, what in the world is this? So I don't know if God was trying to tell me something. But we're taking care of it. And I thank God for that. But that's a weed. That's a weed. A weed that I knew I didn't want. So and I couldn't live amongst that weed. I had to get rid of that weed, move it on out the way.
I said, sometimes you can have good weeds, because we fertilized my yard and I had wild flowers to grow in the yard, which made it beautiful. And I consider that as being good weeds.
Well, it was a pretty weed. Ah, but pretty weeds are deceiving. They are deceiving. Yeah, yeah. Yes, it is. We are deceiving. Yeah, sounds good. Yeah, I'm gonna fall for that one. Yeah, that's how the scams come about. Another parable that he gives illustrates how even in good conditions, weeds can begin to grow among the good plants. And so we know we got to, when they start growing among the good plants, we got to go and pull those weeds out. The good seeds that thrive and are fruitful represent the people who follow Christ. The weeds are those people who object Jesus' teachings and God's will. This issue presented is how to cultivate and harvest a good growth while preventing the crops' contamination by the weeds. So our goal is to keep the weeds from growing. We need to speak to the weed, because we need to have that weed change its course and not be a weed, but become the seed for Christ. We don't want it to just lay out there, just sit out there and keep going the way that it's going. We've got to do everything that we can to bring forth the word of God to make a difference. And we do that in the way that we tell our story, we share our stories, and I've heard people complain about others sharing their story. But I believe there's always somebody there who needs to hear your story and to know that if God did it for them, he can do it for me. So our stories are important. We need to learn how to share and not let people think that we've been goody-goody-two-shoes, because we're still not goody-goody-two-shoes. We can do good at putting on a show, but we need to be real with people. And then that's how we draw them in, with our story, knowing about what God has done for me in my life, how he has brought me through, how he has fed me and clothed me when I didn't have a thing in the world. God was right there. And if he does it for me and he gives me the mind, he gives me the spirit to share my story, to share what I have, surely something will rub off on me. Something. And you may not show me, but I know something's going to rub off on you. You're going to show somebody. Because God sees all, God knows all. And he'll put you in that position where you got to share it, where you got to tell it. Amen? Amen. Brother Bob. The parable of the weeds is an illustration of how people of God will continue to exist among unbelievers who live a worldly lifestyle. That's not going to change. Everybody is not going to come to Jesus. They are not going to recognize that he's waiting with arms wide open to receive them. There are some that are meant to be lost, and it will happen. People look at our conditions, how the world is nowadays, and they see through the worldly eyes. They're not seeing through God's eyes. See, when God led me to the realization that he's in control of everything, he's in control of Donald Trump. He's in control of him. Yeah, he does a lot of foolish things, but when God says stop, guess what? He's got to stop. He can't go any further. So we have to pray to God and recognize that he is the one. He's the power. And stop looking at Donald Trump. Stop taking all that negativity in, even from Rick Scott, because we know what Rick Scott is all about now. He's running for office, and he wants our votes. So now we count. But where have we been all these years? Where have we been then? You didn't count then. But now we're somebody. Hey, I was somebody all the time. You just refused to recognize me. So guess what? I cannot recognize you now. Because I know it's just for you to get in office. And then what you gonna do? Turn your back on me again. The seed. All right, Carter has a show now. Amen. Come on.
Yeah. Okay, I just want to do the summary. When you look at the church group book there, and look at the summary last week, and go through the summary, and the summary says what? It says that the parable of the harvest reminds us that it is God who ultimately will judge us all. Our human instincts suggest to us that we want to be in an environment that is free of weeds and tear. Wouldn't that be nice to go somewhere that you can just be free of that? But that's like my yard there. But that's not living in a real world, is it? But this parable reminds us that in some cases, we are entangled with one another. Only God can separate the underlying sins of our society that traps us, revealing the real issues that need to be removed and leaving hearts open to receive the love that is needed for healing and restoration.